Can you explain what is ordination and actually how has it evolved from the first century and what the disciples did to where we are today? It's a big question.
The word ordination actually comes from the Latin concept of ordo, which is applied during the third century by Tertullian and Cyprian to the concept of what happens to the change in order to a Christian person going from a laity to a clergy. The idea that you have a change of class and kind is right there in the construct of what ordo means. In the Roman world, there was not that much change of classes. We are living in a society here in America where class changes can happen within a generation or sometimes even within a matter of a few years.
Right.
Win the lottery and you change classes. But that's not the way it was in the Roman world. If you were going to go from a citizen to an equestrian class, you had to go through a series of processes, and it was understood that you were changing your ordo, your order. You were changing. And if you go from the equestrian class to the senatorial class, again, there is processes, ceremonies, including religious ceremonies, that changed your class order in society. So you became a different thing. And that's the concept behind ordination, which is why I'm really not all that in favor of using the word at all.
Right.
But we have adopted the word from Christian history. And it has been the way we have designated who is ministry and who is laity and the process of choosing specific leaders needs to happen. And that did happen in the New Testament with the laying on of hands. You have the concept of choosing leaders, recognizing the Holy Spirit's gifting, the Holy Spirit's choosing, and then the body of believers endorses the Holy Spirit's choice, is essentially what happens, which is very different than what an ordo change in Roman society. In Roman society, it's by a vote of the Senate or by a movement of change of economic status, etc., that you then start taking part in a very human process of changing an order, as opposed to a divine-led process that leads people to choose leaders from among them. So the difference between the laying on of hands and ordination is quite a bit different. The recognition that we have to have something to call it is there.
Right.
But when we call it ordination, we bring a lot of baggage.
It's interesting. So you're saying that when the disciples, it says that Jesus ordained 12, that this was a different type of ordination than what happened, you know, how it evolved in like the third century where it became a status of class. And it was, I think, you know, the church was trying to explain to a secular world what leadership is in the church, or how did that term really get adopted into the church? Was that, were we trying to placate culture? Were we trying to explain ourselves to culture? Like how did that enter into our vocabulary in that sense?
Well, yes, we were trying to placate culture. It was the Tertullian actually is the person who introduces the term, and he's very class conscious. He's very aware of how things look in society. He's very conscious that of things that if you have, for instance, a woman that has had a husband die, that in culture, the higher classes are supposed to remarry so that they will continue to have children to keep the class up. But in a ascetic environment, you're never supposed to have more than one marriage. So the reality is he told his wife, if I die, don't you dare remarry. And he's very conscious of what things look like in culture. So to look as if we are a Christian people of ascetic nature, then we need to actually have the markers very much in place. And one of those markers is the lack of any kind of remarriage. And in fact, marriages are best only having sexuality for the purpose of childbearing, not for the purpose of togetherness, etc. And so he kind of begins the thing that Augustine nails down as the passage of sin is through sexuality, and that sin and sexuality are integrally related, so that sexuality is always bad. This is the opposite of what the Bible tells us, that sexuality was created as something good, and it was God invented, and it was has been twisted. But the reality is it starts good. So, but this becomes a border issue. And border issues and cultural signs become very important for somebody like Tertullian. Right. And so the cultural sign that we have to have clear distinction between who's leading and who's following, that fits in an empirical culture, an imperial culture. So where you are used to a hierarchical structure where emperors make laws and Senate back them up, and then the people are just the sheep that obey. In that environment, then the marker of a clear distinction of difference in class and kind between the leaders and the followers is important to project to the society so that they can understand. We have a little bit different a situation here in America in that we have a democratic society.
Right.
And so we have songs about any boy can be president. Now, why they didn't say any person could be president, that was culturally defined, by the way. That the time that message was written, time that song was written, it was unthinkable to have a woman president. But why? Because of residual, even in our democratic society, because of residual cultural understandings that have come down to us. And so we end up with cultural differences today that were established before Rome was an empire and were followed through during the Roman Empire. So we're following these class cultural distinctions even today.